couple of potential possessions of nouns and records, and then individual human filling out the E's.
If you could come guess from the table, there is a main character of my talk is the lambda verb. And today I'll explain how it is used to prove integrativity of the movement. Just let me tell you what is lambda brackets, and then I'll explain how it is used big. And then I'll go through it. The model of the ring of polynomials that actually can be calculated. One puts comma instead of lambda. Mm-hmm. But this will be very similar to the usual bracket, but it will depend on the parameter lambda. Then there is this typographical trick to replace comma with lambda, then it will be the
which is polynomial in lambda.
It is bilinear over there. It says linear in D. Which means the following. First, it means that D is a derivation. And second, it means that if you want to take D from the first spot, you can just put minus lambda. Lambda is an indeterminate which commutes with D and with the series. So this is the lambda bracket.
So how does D act on lambda?
D and lambda commute. D acts here.
Yeah. Okay. There is no D.
Yeah. So if you want to compute lambda bracket D A with B, you just compute. It's just almost bilinearity. That's where I will test it. And an important and so this replaces bilinearity for the usual gear. Now I should say what is the skew symmetry in Jacobian ring. So R is O and lambda is O. If in addition we have so if you ignore lambda immunity, it's just usual Jacobian. And secondly, species. That the what is B lambda, right? As usual, you put negative A, but not lambda B. Here you put minus lambda, minus. This little arrow means that what is this? You take A mu B, put powers of mu on the left, and then replace it by minus lambda minus. So D adds from the left.
Lambda is a number.
Yeah, lambda is formal by the B. You can view it as a number. Okay. And D is a number. Okay.
Is it reasonable to ask for an explicit example?
Okay, example.
the favorite example of everybody is the Hasiba.
Need a formal algebra. It is one dimensional. Plus, so it is a module of f of d plus 4.
Where c is 0.
And then c is a central element, so lambda bracket is anything is 0. So we should say what is l lambda. And thus, it is d plus 2 lambda l plus lambda 2. And one can prove that if you have rank 1 Riemann formal algebra, it is a trivial order of the Riemann. And another example, of course everything is in the slides, is what is denoted by current G, where G is in the algebra, and then for you define A lambda B as usual bracket, plus in the product lambda t, where t is. And g is simply or reductive term, and it's an invariant linear. This is called the current Riemann formal algebra. And the general theorem says that these are all finite rank simple Riemann formal algebra. This is the first definition. But for the partial differential equation, we need, you know, that if you study Hamiltonian ordinary differential equation, then you should endow the space of functions with the ordinary algebra bracket. Then now to move to the Hamiltonian partial differential, then it's almost the same. Except that on the right, you replace lambda usual bracket by lambda bracket. And you put down the equals. Usual notion integral is a map from the space of functions in D. As the corresponding structure which underlies this equation is what is called Poisson vertex structure. And this is actually very close to the subject of this talk. Actually, all of this is really part of differential algebra. Namely, it is the differential algebra. So in particular, of course, it is a module of the polynomial system. In doubt, with a lambda bracket. Which is denoted customarily in the classical equations, one uses curly brackets, and in the quantum, square brackets. Such that V with this lambda bracket is a Riemann formal algebra. And in addition, as in the usual Poisson algebra case, Leibniz rule, A lambda B So this is a waiting field. And I put them on the web so that you can memorize them and present you know what the thing is. Now I can go through my talk and explain a bit here. I would say that the three main directions in which the theory, they were introduced about 20 years ago, and the main, I would say, three directions in which in chronological order in which it developed is first purely kind of theoretic thing, classification of certain infinite dimensional algebras, classification of differential algebras. It's part of the story. But I will not talk about it today. The second direction is its relation with vertex algebra. They call vertex operator algebra. The word vertex here refers to interaction of certain quantum field at vertices of the Feynman diagram. But unfortunately, this name vertex just persisted in the also moved into the classical situation. Poisson vertex algebras have nothing to do with vertices. The only relation is that there are classical limits of vertex algebras, which somehow do have something to do. And finally, the third in chronological order direction where this notion was developed is application to the theory of integrable Hamiltonian partial differential equation. You see, the progress here consists of the following thing. What previously people were doing in Hamiltonian partial differential equations is to study ordinary bracket on this quotient distance. And this is just, you take the lambda bracket as a g, you put lambda equals zero. And it's obvious from the axioms that if you put in all these axioms lambda and mu equals zero, and quotient by d, which means you put d equals zero, you get the ordinary, usual axioms of any algebra. So what's good about Lie conformal algebra is that they induce on the quotient space the algebra bracket by this quotient. And then everything in the Hamiltonian theory is stated in these terms, in terms of this bracket, in particular in the top of Newton. But of course, if you take this quotient space, then you lose the product. The Leibniz rule doesn't hold anymore. And therefore, it's pretty difficult to check why the Jacobi identity holds. And so a natural desire, and I don't know why it was hasn't been done before, is to lift yourself into the space V, to find a structure such as when you go to the quotient space, it induces the Lie algebra structure. And so the main point is that the structure is lambda bracket. Okay. Let me now go through the results which were obtained using this method. So we've written quite a few papers on this. The first application was to the classification of scalar Poisson structures, which was known in the 70s and 80s only up to order 3, but we were able to solve it at least conjecturally for all orders. The next thing, which also I'm not going to explain, is computation of relational Poisson homology. Yeah, this I will explain. Misha talked his talk about the Dirichlet Sokolov hierarchies, but using lambda brackets, the whole picture becomes much simpler and absolutely purely algebraic and rigorous. Except, and also it can be generalized to many other situations which I'm going to explain. Of course, related to Dreyfus autohypography is Adler Geffen Dicke theory. And in fact, Dreyfus autohypography, Adler Geffen Dicke is nothing else but the reduction applied to the algebra essentially generally. Secondly, I will explain that what I said so far is local to Poisson stretch. But lambda brackets can be also made non-local, and it's very important because most of the equations don't have local Poisson structures, but they have a very important non-local, even such very famous equations like the non-linear Schrödinger. Then I will explain what is general Dirac reduction. It was introduced by Dirac in 1950. And it's a very beautiful procedure how to go from what we call second class constraints to construct Poisson bracket in the reduced state. And it turns out that if you use lambda bracket, then the formula is of Dirac goes almost the same, just with a little decoration. So what is my point? That if you go from, want to go from Lie algebra to Lie conformal algebra, everything remains almost the same, except that you add some little decorations. And this situation persists throughout the case. And so lambda bracket is a really very nice guiding principle, how to go from finite dimensional situation to the infinite dimensional. And lastly, about non-commutative Hamiltonian PDE. This business is closely related to subject which probably will be discussed in this talk, and this is Rota-Baxter equation. Something which is defined. All right. First, let me begin with usually if you read both with the literature on integrable systems, people never see what is the algebra functions of that. And that is because it is a pretty tricky equation. Some people can see the analytic function, some neuromorphic, some field, and so on. But of course, the right thing to do is to put into the theory of integrable systems is a framework of differential algebra. Functions are just in differential algebra. And so, but endowed with some additional structure. And this is what is the first basic definition. What is algebra of functions? Where the study is integrable Hamiltonian or more general evolution equation. It should be a differential algebra with a derivation d.
You mean algebra of function or differential function? An algebra of...
Yeah, the algebra function which we study in the theory of Hamiltonian or evolution equation is called algebra of differential function. So, axiomatically, what is algebra of differential power? First of all, it's a differential algebra, V, endowed with a derivation D, exactly the derivation G which appears at the end, which is called total derivative. For example, this function U usually would be a function of X, and times the derivative by X is what is this capital D. It's called total derivative. And but in addition, it is endowed with commuting partial derivatives such that the following two axioms hold. First of all, almost all partial derivatives still function. And secondly, if you commute partial derivatives with total derivative, you have this idea. Of course, in the theory of integral systems, everybody knows this identity. But for general public, it suffices to say that if you take, for the space of functions, functions in U, U prime, U double prime, etc., which, of course, everybody in the field of differential algebra knows it, it's called algebra of differential polynomials. Then it is an example of algebra of differential functions, namely what is D everybody know, just un goes to un plus 1. And also you have partial derivatives of these polynomials, D un, I can see this scalar case, which is one group. Mm-hmm. One can see also. And of course, I suppose many of you know, if you don't know, you can easily check that this identity then will hold. So this is an example of an algebra differential. Axiom 1 is absolutely necessary because then you cannot even define what evolutionary vector field is, which is the most basic notion of the theory. Because you have this infinite sum which involves but if you apply this evolutionary field to a function, then of course you only find the tensor by. And here it's a good point to say when evolutionary equation is just a question of what du over dt equals f of t prime, f of t prime. And to this you associate the evolutionary vector field Sf, which is given by this formula. And this equation is called integrable. If there are infinitely many chi-symmetries. Chi-symmetry means just F, say, n, such that F0 is F, and all evolution, the corresponding evolutionary vector fields can be. This is definition of the vector. Or as people usually in the theory of integrable systems say, the equation is integrable if the flow defined by this equation commutes with infinitely many other flows which commute between the cells. And for me, it was the main stumbling block, the phrase commuting flows. I just, for a long time, I just couldn't understand what people were talking about. So it's a purely the algebraic situation. Of course, algebraically, this evolutionary vector fields, they form a Lie algebra, and so the question of studying or classifying integrable equations is a question of classifying infinite dimensional abelian subalgebras in the Lie algebra of evolutionary vector. So it's a purely algebraic. But since everything is infinite dimensional, of course it's a very difficult algebraic. And it so here I give the definition of algebra differential polynomials in every number of variables. Sometimes they even need to be infinite, like for example for the KP equation. But very often it's not enough to consider on the algebra of differential polynomials, because, for example, this famous Pichler-Novikov equation, just the right-hand side itself contains the prime and the denominator. So you're really forced to go outside. And of course, if you invert some of UIs, or even perform some more complicated operations, you'll still will have an algebra of differential function, so you can study it as a Pichler. However, there is a very dangerous thing here that you should always avoid, that you cannot extend the action of D or polynomials in D to the action of, for example, Varan polynomials in D, because the inverse cannot be defined at all if you want the both axioms of the algebra of differential functions to work. But I will explain how you can how you can, what you should do if you want to consider the pseudo differential, etc. And it's important because I live here.
But if you, in what you grant, is it still true that someone if you differentiate and can get a higher power in the numerator?
Yeah, yes, it doesn't matter. It's still, if you allow arbitrary finite power as a denominator, it's still you get the derivative on the finite power. Because you apply polynomials in T, not formal power series. Yeah, you cannot apply formal power series. Okay. Now, how, now I will explain. It looks, of course, a little strange why you should do this thing, not something else. But let me now explain that it is the only way to do things. And namely, you can find out this formula, so in practice they were found in a different way. But just beginning with what physicists call local plus one structure. It is given by this equation. You take two functions. You take, for example, differential polynomials, or more general algebra differential functions. And you define a bracket of function of ui of s in which j of y as a differential operator in u of y up to n prime applied to the delta function. Of course, you can find this formula in any textbook on integrable systems. And if you are playing like myself, you study it and you can come to what this actually means. And it took a long time to understand that actually, and moreover, they take not only differential operator, but pseudo-differential operator. But this is a little completely crazy. And in fact, all of it is very easy if you introduce lambda bracket. And what is a lambda bracket? Let me tell you how you introduce it. First of all, if you take this physicist formula and extend it by the Leibniz rule and by linearity, then you can define a Poisson bracket of two functions by this formula. It just logically follows immediately from the previous one. In particular, if f and x is ui and uj, you get previous one. Now, I need to remind you what is variational derivative, and here it is as definition. I suppose everybody knows what variational derivative is, but let me sum it. Of course, everybody knows it from variational calculus. And again, in order to define variational derivative, certainly you need the first action on the finite domain. So what do you do? So you have this formula, which is not clear what it actually means. But you can perform all kind of formal operations with it. Integral is already defined, and is defined here. That if you integrate by parts the formula 2, then you get this equation. It is bracket of integral of f is u, it is given by this operator h applied to the variational derivative. And this is usually at least is the right hand side of the integral partial differential. And finally, integrating by both variables, you get this formula. And this is the formula which actually Misha quoted in his talk. It's formula for the Poisson bracket on the space V mod D. And of course, the basic requirement is that this is the Lie algebra bracket. And then the classical definition is that if you have a differential, metric differential operator for a scalar differential operator in the case of one variable, then local Poisson structure, this notion can be derived from this notion of local Poisson structure given by physics. Is that it is a differential operator which is Q self-adjoint, and if you want the Jacobian identity hold, then entries of H should satisfy certain cubic identity, which is called usually scope. But then there's some complicated identity. And the first basic definition is what is the Hamiltonian evolution equation? It is this equation where this bracket is given by this previous formula 3. And it is a usual way to write partial differential Hamiltonian equations. And finally, if you have two a local functional is just the element of this Poisson space in DV, and they are called in involution as a commutator is zero. And one of the most basic remarks is that if you take a local functional and map it to this evolutionary vector field, then it will be a Lie algebra homomorphism. And so if you can construct infinite dimensional abelian subalgebra on the space of local functionals, then its image, if H has a finite dimensional kernel, will give you an infinite dimensional commutative Lie algebra of evolutionary vector fields. And therefore, if you have infinite remaining linearly independent integrals of motion, then automatically you have your equation will be linear. That's why it is important to study Hamiltonian linear. Okay. Yeah, what I explained very quickly is the classical point of view. And it just says that everybody knows what is the usual Hamiltonian equation. But then if you want to pass from the usual Hamiltonian equation, ordinary differential Hamiltonian equation, to the Hamiltonian partial differential equation, you have to replace everywhere gradients of functions for their variational derivative. And one unpleasant thing in addition, that you cannot talk about functions. You want to talk about local functionals, namely elements from V mod D. But again, this can be avoided by using the lambda bracket. And so basic idea is that just introduce a Fourier transform of this bracket, which didn't make much sense, and formally computed, you can derive the following formula, which if you remove all decorations, all these lambdas and this, then it will be the usual formula for the Poisson bracket in the finite dimensional theory, namely bracket F is G is equal to gradient of F
the opulent and what is the gradient ratio.
But in the case of lambda bracket, the formula becomes more complicated. But it's more complicated only in the sense that instead of Lie algebra actions, it satisfies the lambda bracket. Namely, as I already mentioned, you have Leibniz rules. As we, I already introduced Leibniz rule, but from speciality you can get the point. Left Leibniz rule. You have set collinearity, which I already introduced. These two are equivalent to say the first and the D is the derivative of the lambda bracket. Yeah, here, of course, there is a misprint. The bracket not 6 but 4. This bracket. Or if you want, or if you want this bracket. So this bracket is Lie algebra. Yes, so bracket 4 is a Lie algebra if and only if these two properties hold. And these are exactly the axioms of a Lican formula. So that's what you are really forced to introduce Lican formula algebras on the space of functions. In order for on the space of local functions, V mod dV, this Lie algebra bracket will satisfy the algebra. Okay, I already told you, and it's on the blackboard, what is the algebra, the conformal algebra, what is the class of vertex algebra. So, and this there is this master formula, let me interpret for a second, which expresses the lambda bracket in terms of the differential operator H. It is a main example of a lambda bracket, and this is the one which is used in the theory of Hamiltonian wave. Yeah, this is the last is well known definition of Poisson structures, and they're compatible with the sums again of Poisson structure. And here are examples. If you have, you know, in these cases, the algebra differential functions is just algebra differential polynomials. And by cis-collinearity, it suffices to define lambda bracket only on U, because on U prime it automatically falls from this linearity. The first very famous example from 1971 is by Gardner, Shadyev, and Zakharov. And in this sense, it's just a lambda bracket to U with the short is lambda. The other one I already explained to you, this is in the theory of integral systems, it's called the Rossorum-Madley Poisson structure. And it's actually two compatible structures because it depends on one parameter and all of them are Poisson structures. And if you apply the so-called linear Madley scheme of integrability, which I will briefly explain, then you get the KDE equation, which was explained in the initial school. Now, a Lennard Madley scheme consists of constructing local functionals inductively. That's why here you can put also integral, and it's well defined because variational derivative applied to z if you see it. This is goes to that earlier observation. So the question is this, that if you have so what is Hamiltonian equation? It's equation of the form d u over dt equals to this. Then if it can be written in two different forms, like here, and if this can be extended to infinity for n, all n greater than equal to n 0, than 1, then the lemma of Lennard says that all of this HIs will be the norm. Then in this case, you get an infinite hierarchy of Hamiltonian equations associated to the entire system. So, you know that if you want to construct integral equations, you want to construct algebra of differential functions, introduce two lambda brackets which are compatible. Which means that any the linear combination is again written form of algebra brackets. And of course, basic example, the two basic examples are the ones which are written on the blackboard. So this is the one parameter family depending on C of lambda brackets. And here another two parameter family depending on this thing. And both produce for known integrable equations using the Lennard scheme. But the main difficulty of the Lennard scheme, it shows that the sequence can be extended indefinitely as n goes to infinity. Because each time you have to solve certain equations, it's not clear a priori why this can be solved. There are various methods to do it. Yeah, here I wanted to introduce another, to show that there are, of course, many equations for many unknown functions. So here it is two-dimensional lambda bracket, which appears in the theory of modular spaces. But I don't have time to go. And it produces many very interesting new Hamiltonian integrable. And then there are various theorems which show you that that this can be Lennard-Magri scheme can be extended to infinity, which I also discussed. And now I will recall you again the basic definitions, but now in the language of lambda brackets. I told you in the classical language of variational derivatives, but in the terms of lambda brackets, which are of course much more invariant language, it is that on the space of local functions, which is just V mod dV, if you have on V lambda bracket, then on V mod dV, you have this very simple bracket, and in the, if the lambda bracket on V is a satisfies Cushing and Jacobian density, then this bracket satisfies the algebra of axioms, and actually goes both ways. It's necessary sufficient. And the second formula actually defines a representation of the Lie algebra V mod dV on the algebra of functions V. It is also defined using the lambda bracket. And again, it's very easy to prove that it is a representation of this Lie algebra. So the whole thing becomes really representation theory. We have a Lie algebra of local functions, we have this representation of the space of all functions, and our main problem is to construct infinite dimensional abelians of algebras in the algebra of local functions.
And finally, Hamiltonian equation is just this. As I said, there are many instances, actually the majority of instances, when the usual lambda bracket, we'll say Bokov lambda bracket, when it's polynomial in lambda, is not sufficient. For example, the Poisson linear Schrödinger, the corresponding Poisson structure, is not Bokov, it involves the index. And then, the idea is that the lambda bracket should be, the notion of lambda bracket should be extended. And it turns out that the right thing to do is the lambda bracket take values in Laurent polynomials and lambda inverse. So you allow only finitely many positive powers of lambda, but also you allow infinitely many negative powers of lambda. And then the basic observation is that you cannot even formulate what is the Jacobi identity. Of course, formulas are the same, but you cannot compare the left and right hand side. Because in this Jacobi identity, various terms lie in different spaces. As you know, if you take Laurent polynomials in lambda, and after that Laurent series in lambda, and then Laurent series in mu, or do the other way around, you get completely different space. Unlike in the case of formal power theory. You can permute in the case of formal power theory, you get the same space. But V of lambda mu is not equal to V. Just think a little about this if you need to see. And this creates the difficulty even in saying what is Jacobi identity. But with Alberto De Sola, we studied in detail this non-local lambda brackets, and we found a very simple admissibility property, which is here. And we proved that in this case, that in the case when our Hamiltonian, our Poisson structure H of D is a rational single differential order, which means that it's a ratio of two differential order. Then this lambda bracket is admissible, one can develop the whole theory of non-local lambda brackets and apply to the theory of differential order. Here are some of the most famous examples of non-local Poisson structures. First is the inverse, which plays an important role in the total vertices. The second was introduced by Sokolov to prove interoperability of the feature of Novikov equation. This is another structure which is compatible with it, which was later introduced by Dorfman. But the earliest was probably this one, which was 2x2 introduced by Margaret, who proved that it is Poisson structure for the nonlinear Schrödinger equation, which I'm not going to write here. And it turns out that you can also develop linear Margaret scheme for the non-local equation. But for this, you really need to develop a theory of rational pseudo-differential operators. Okay, so what is a rational pseudo-differential operator? Is there any theory? Is it just a differential operator divided by another? And it turns out that they form an algebra, and because differential operators form a set of so-called order conditions.
But what was unknown, and it's completely inexplicable why, I was asking many experts, but people saw that it is not true. But in fact, it turned out to be true, that the algebra of rational differential, cubic differential, whatever, has the same property as rational numbers. Namely, of course, you can represent it in many ways as ratio of quadrants. And the question, will this be two fractions related as in the case of rational numbers? And the answer is yes. That all these fractions can be obtained from one kind of minimal fraction just by multiplying numerator and denominator on the right with the same differential order. So all arithmetic properties of rational numbers, they do hold also for the rational differential order. And on the basis of this, one can develop the theory of non-local structures and apply them to the integrability of equations defined by non-local independent structures. Yes, here are the main results, some of the main results in this direction. And if you ask me how to prove this, it turns out that the best proof and the most clear one, and you can try to do it yourself, is to use the theory of non-commutative principle ideal ring. It is a ring where every left and every right ideal is space. Then many things of the theory of principle ideal domains work in this very general way. And in general, it's quite a remarkable theory, the theory of Noetherian non-commutative algebra, which is really difficult to bring it there. But then, of course, the first question which comes to mind, if you have, you can write formally, of course, again, a Hamiltonian equation in the traditional terms, it's written like that. Then if h of d is a differential order, it's clear what it means. But what it means if it is pseudo-differential order, like d inverse? And we know that d inverse cannot be applied. So how you would define such a thing? And then the answer is extremely simple. Namely, this is the best interpretation. So what does it mean? This can be defined not for arbitrary pseudo-differential operator, but for a rational one. If your operator is ratio A and B, what does it mean to apply it to dH of d? What means in general equality? So an element P is equal to AB inverse applied to C. The definition is very simple. So we say that P is equal to this if there exists F such that C equals BF, then of course P is equal to AF. So this equality is defined in by definition. And by the way, such F exists if this fractional differential operator is minimal. And it is minimal. And so using this definition, one can rigorously proceed to develop the Lennard matrix scheme and prove integrability of many equations in a rigorous way. Of course, here is this theory, which is briefly described. And here I even state the theorem which will prove about what are sufficient conditions of integrability. Since I don't have much time, let me just
Let me now move to the Greenfield Sokolov hierarchies in engineerization. The basic thing here is the notion of a classical Hamiltonian reduction. Misha explained what it is in kind of more geometric terms, but in order to develop the theory in a rigorous way, it turns out that the language of lambda brackets is the most appropriate one. Namely, the situation is the following. Suppose that you have a Lican formal algebra R and Poisson vertex algebra E. Suppose you have a homomorphisms from R to B as Lican formal algebra. Of course, the classical situation is just you should skip the word of V algebra, because it's the usual definition of Hamiltonian reduction. Let I0 will be Poisson vertex algebra ideal in the symmetric, of course, symmetric algebra over V algebra is the Poisson algebra, K of Poisson Poisson algebra. And it turns out that the usual symmetric algebra of the Lican formal algebra is again Poisson vertex algebra. Now take ideal generated by the image of I0. Then if you take quotient by this ideal, V mod I, it is not a Poisson vertex algebra. Then you have to take invariance with respect to lambda action of the subalgebra. Then it is a Poisson vertex algebra in a complete analogy of Poisson of Hamiltonian reduction for Lie groups. So it's a very general situation which allows you to produce new Poisson vertex algebras from the existing one. And of course, the most general, so lambda bracket is defined in natural way, but this this is not, lambda bracket is not well defined on V mod I, but it is well defined if you take invariance. This is a well-known properties known from the Poisson geometry, and it is of course known in this situation. And of course the main example is the following. The classical W algebra associated to a simple algebra G and an important element L. So you just apply the general construction. For V you take symmetric algebra. Lambda bracket, I already introduced this example. And so this is affine by Poisson structure. And then finally, there is this famous ideal generated by elements of this form, M minus F of M. And so if you apply the above general construction, you get a Poisson, a very nice Poisson vertex algebra. And of course, the simplest of them is was studied by Greenfield Sokolov, but of course in a different language, there was no lambda bracket at the time. But they just studied this space of local functions, and they constructed this famous Greenfield Sokolov hierarchy mentioned by Misha in his talk. But it turns out that this can be generalized for any important F, but unfortunately, with some additional properties. Namely, the property is that that if you add, so what is this element F? In the case of Greenfield Sokolov, it is this, it was mentioned by Misha. So this is principally important. And S, if you take for S this one, then you get the cyclic element which is semi-simple. And it turns out that you can push through the theory of Greenfield Sokolov if this property persists, namely if this element f, we can add an element as maximum fh in volume by eh and f is specific. Then this element should be semi-semi. But unfortunately, this property doesn't always hold. For example, for exceptional algebras, it holds only for about one set of all important elements. And then, of course, a natural question arises that if you have such a Poisson vertex algebra, which is called classical affine W algebra, then for which the associated to this Poisson, actually by Poisson algebra, there is this, the corresponding hierarchy of Hamiltonian PD is in. Of course, Griffin Sokolov of proved it for the principle important, and as I said, they proved it for this case when it was tested semi-simple. And then gave really very interesting new equation. For example, in the case when F is the opposite of principle important. Principle important is what? Its orbit has maximum dimension. And let's consider F whose orbit has minimum dimension. And it turns out that you get really a lot of very interesting equations, and some of them were really very, turned out to be very famous equations. And this is one of the examples. If you take the Lie algebra SLM, and for F you take this element EN1, just the minimal one, when you put just one two. Then you can construct the corresponding integrable hierarchy. And it turns out that after the Dirac reduction, which I will explain in a moment, you get a quite famous Yajima-Oikawa hierarchy, which describes formation and interaction of sonic when mu is solid. Don't ask me what this is. But it's really a very classical equation studied. And there is a generalization of the which we can skip for a moment. Just let me take a couple of hints to explain another application of the bracket for the theory of Dirac reduction in the infinite dimensional. What is it? What is the usual Dirac reduction? If you have a Poisson algebra and you have some elements in this Poisson algebra, you want to take quotient as an algebra generated by ideal of this element theta. And then on it, the induced Poisson structure is not defined because it is not necessarily a Poisson ideal. As Dirac called it, the second class constructive. It is Poisson ideals for the first class constraint, second, if it is not. Then the idea of Dirac was to introduce the Poisson brackets of the corresponding of this constraint, this element theta I, and then use it to construct a new Poisson bracket, which is a well-defined Poisson bracket. And we do it just exactly the same, except that for, instead of Poisson brackets, we take Poisson lambda bracket. So we construct this matrix. And then the theorem says that if this matrix, of course there is one drawback that the matrix is in Dirac theory. This matrix should be an invertible operator. And then you define by this formula a new bracket where you add to the old bracket this sum. Dirac did many years ago in 1950 exactly the same thing, except that he didn't have this declaration, it was just common. And he proved, of course, what is the basic property of this? Is that it is symmetric, which is obvious. Secondly, that this theta is a central element, is also present, which is obvious. But what is not obvious, and even in Dirac, pretty short paper, it takes about 2 pages to check, and he puts it in. That miraculously it satisfies the Jacobian. And here miraculously
it's again satisfies the Jacobian identity.
And so you get new on the factor algebra, you get a new Poisson structure, which is going to come. There is one example of it, which I found in the literature later, namely, if you just reduce by some of the generators of the algebra, some of the UIs, then it corresponds to this, if you take the Poisson operator, and then you just reduce, just you introduce a new bracket defined by this formula, and it turns out to be a Poisson bracket. But let me note that, of course, using this procedure, you get, even if you had a local Poisson structure, you get a non-local one. So it's really very important to go outside of the realm of local Poisson structures. Yeah, okay. Yes, Buffy, can I take another couple of minutes?
Yeah, 10 more minutes.
I can take 10 minutes?
10 minutes.
Ah,
including right. Questions.
Okay,
yeah, 5 minutes. 5 questions.
Another important part of the theory is Adler-Gelfand-Dicke theory, which of course was generalized by Greenfield and Sokol, but in the case when G is GLN, the theory is actually richer than it is in the. But I don't know how to move the thing to the left. Ah, okay.
Right, left.
Okay, so this is. Yeah, it is a very. Just by studying the papers of Gelfand-Dicke and especially of Adler, we introduce this notion of the Adler type. It's the differential order. It is defined by this rather strange relation that suppose that you have a Poisson that picks out the B, and you have elements in the differential order. Then, if the pseudo differential order satisfies this equation, the lambda bracket is given by this quadratic relation. The IZ is expansion in Z when Z tends to infinity. So Z should be put in the denominator. And then it turns out that this is really quite a remarkable equation, which I wrote it only in the scalar field, but also can be written in the metric scale, which is just here. Okay. Then first of all, you automatically get a Poisson vertex. Secondly, you can apply it Adler type identity to construct the by Poisson structure, you just subtract constant from L. Thirdly, you can construct infinitely many conserved densities using this famous fractional powers of Gelfand. And the theorem is that if you write down the following sequence of equations, you get five Hamiltonian equations, which are in two different forms. And so therefore it is integral because it's infinitely many equations. Or it's equivalent form is just in the form of flux. It's a hierarchy equation depending on infinitely many variables, quantity, etc. But the nth equation is written in the flux form. So of course, as usual, plus is a differential part, assuming differential equation. And the theorem is that all these HNs are integrals to different evolution for all these evolution equations. In particular, where this operator, yes, so the main examples, of course, the Gelfand-Dicke example. when you take just a differential, just a very simple differential order without any additional relations on the y. It's easy to see that it's a finite type, and as a result, this equations which were written in the previous transparency are integral equation. It's exactly the nth gap from the hierarchy, in particular for n equals 2, it's key. But now, if you take this operator, which is of infinite order, and it's the only example of non-rational single differential operators that is in the equation, you get this famous AP parameter by Hamiltonian equation. But what's remarkable is that you get not only the system of this equation, so of course the integral derivative, you immediately get the corresponding Poisson structure. Because you remember, if you have other type operator, it provides you a space of functions which with the Poisson structure. Yeah, and finally, it was just recently that we published this paper that as I said, there was a long-standing problem whether for any double algebra there exists a corresponding integrable hierarchy. So we can prove it for this importance, for which I already explained, for any simple algebra. But for GLN, we can prove it for all importance. And this requires completely a different method, that for any important element f, the corresponding double algebra carries an integrable hierarchy. Also can prove for syncretic, but already for orthogonal, there are problems that we are not sure that it's still working. Thank you.
Is there a classification of, for example, rank one absolute differential operators which gives rise to vertex algebra? So which satisfies all identities?
To Poisson
vertex.
Yes. As I said, that in scalar case, it was known that, since the order is skew-symmetric, it should have odd order. So for order one, it was proved many years ago by many people that it's only D. For order three, it is this one.
And this is the only?
Yeah, it is only one. For order five, it is already pretty complicated. And after that, it was unknown. But using the method of lambda brackets, we went up to order 13. And then we found out that for order 11, it is extremely complicated. And one of the solvers took about 12 pages of computer printout to write down. But all of a sudden, beginning from 13, it becomes extremely simple and beautiful answer, but which we proved only for 13, but our conjecture is that it has the same for all of us.
So you have kind of algorithmic procedure?
Yeah, how to... Yeah, and of course the method of lambda bracket really essentially simplifies the computation.
Okay, any other question? Yeah.
So maybe I got it wrong, but since at the beginning you mentioned that you are going to talk something about the root of x algebra.
Ah, yeah, this I haven't mentioned in my talk. You see, of course it is natural to study evolutionary equations not only when this blue ice commute or you only prime commutes, but also when they don't commute. For example, if you use a matrix. For example, the TDV equation in the non-commutative situation is just this. It is du dt equal to u dt prime plus c u u prime plus u prime u. So you have to, so this is not equal to this because u and u prime do commute. And one can prove that this thing is integral. And how do you do it? For that you can develop again all the theory, Poisson-Gödel subject and so on. But
here comes a very beautiful new idea which was introduced by Vandenberg. The view again introduced, of course, he studied only usual Poisson brackets, already developed Langdon brackets. But its value should lie not in, in the algebra itself, but it should lie in the tensor product of algebra. Because in the non-commutative case, there are very few brackets. The only bracket is just AB minus BA. But if you take it with value in tensor product of algebra, there are many more brackets, and they are very easy. In the case pointing to Jacobi identity, it's nothing but zero to Pax equation.
So
okay, any other questions?
Could I ask a question I shouldn't be asking? The field F, is that constant field, or is that differential?
Yeah, it's a good question. You can take it, the most general situation, F is a differential field.
You see that? That's good.
But as I mentioned in New York a couple of years ago, as I mentioned in the beginning of the talk, there is specification of simple decantonal algebras, but only when F is a constant.
Right.
If it's a differential field, probably the answer is the same, but it's an open problem.
Oh. The thing is that for differential algebraic geometry, the way I've usually seen that is that the central charge is multiplied by constant scalars. And in differential algebraic geometry, since the vid algebra has what we call type 1, you can't have any two cocycles to a type 0 situation. But if it's a multiple of C by the functions, then I think it would be, I think it will work.
Yeah. Yeah,
which would get me the beer zero.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, let's speak.